Good morning. I welcome all of you to the workshop on computational fluid dynamics and heat transfer. In the yesterday's lecture, I had talked about the computational heat advection and then moved on to computational heat convection. And till now, towards the end of the yesterday's lecture, I had started a topic on finite volume method. So I started with computational heat conduction, then moved on to computational heat advection and then computational heat convection. So note the word heat in all these topics. So I had taken in examples of diffusion phenomena, advection phenomena and the combination of the two, convection, taking an example of heat transfer. I had emphasized this yesterday also, that in real world we have a pure diffusion phenomena which is a heat conduction, but in real world we do not have a pure diffusion phenomena as far as momentum transport is concerned, because pure diffusion phenomena in momentum transport corresponds to the sum of the viscous forces acting in a fluid flow situation is equal to 0. And then I took pure advection situation in heat transfer, although in heat transfer also it is an hypothetical situation where the flow rate is very large, but it is not, if you take an example of a momentum transport pure advection phenomena, it is difficult to get a feel of what is happening, because I could take an example of if you are standing between ice and fire only for case of heat transfer, where you have a better feel of this phenomena. But in the when I started the finite volume method yesterday, there the objective is to show you that whatever approximations or whatever finite volume method which we have used for conduction, advection and the combination of the two, convection, are indeed applicable for fluid flow phenomena, momentum transport. So we did in earlier topics, we basically took energy equation. Now we are taking momentum equations, which is also a transport equation, and there is quite an analogy, and that is what is shown through this topic of finite volume method. Towards the end of today's lecture, I'll initiate a new topic, which is on solution of Navier-Stokes equation on a staggered grid. Let us start with today's lecture with an animation which gives the overall philosophy with which we are the finite volume method which is being discussed here. So I'll show you an animation. Okay, so in our, we know what are the conservation laws in fluid mechanics and heat transfer, law of conservation of mass, momentum and energy. And in fluid mechanics as well as heat transfer, from our undergraduate days, the way we do analysis is that we apply this conservation law not in a Lagrangian fashion, but we apply for Eulerian control volumes. So when you take when you follow an Eulerian approach to the and apply the conservation laws, then this is what is done in undergraduate heat transfer and fluid mechanics course, that we apply this conservation law and divide by the volume of the control volume, then we get differential terms and we get a differential equation which is called as the governing partial differential equations. Now this governing partial differential equation, the problem is that this governing partial differential equation, although it is applicable for most of the problems in fluid mechanics and heat transfer, although for more complex situations certain additional terms need to be incorporated in this partial differential equation. But for different problems you get different results, because your shape and size of the domain and the boundary conditions dictate the results. Now this differential equation, I would say that if you can obtain analytical solution of this differential equation for all the fluid mechanics and heat transfer problem, it is like a video camera which has an infinite time and spatial resolution. Okay, what I am trying to say is that if we are able to obtain the analytical solution, what is the analytical solution of a differential equation? Functional relationship. And so in this case, the analytical solution is velocities, pressures and temperature as a function of spatial coordinates and temporal coordinates. So you can create a picture for any values of x, y and z. So it is like a picture with infinite resolution. Secondly, you can create a movie, because in this case it is a function of x, y, z as well as time, and you can put any time step. So you can create a picture, a movie of which has an infinite frame rate. So this is the wish list, and this is one of the most important unresolved problems in science and engineering. It is as big as problem that if you are able to obtain a analytical solution for a general fluid flow problem, then all this CFD software, in fact this subject has to close down. Okay, this is a as big as a problem like this. So this is what we know from our undergraduate days, how to derive the partial differential equation. Now what is done in most of the CFD book is that the differential equation is conservation law per unit volume. We take the volume integral of that differential equation, which is per unit volume. So basically on one side we had divided by volume in case while deriving the equation, and on the other side when we want to get algebraic equation using finite volume method, now we are integrating it. So once we are dividing, or you can say differentiating, and then we are doing integration to get an algebraic equation, which is basically coming from the conservation laws. So rather than following this path, the finite volume method, which is discussed in most of the CFD books, this is what is being done. In fact, in almost all the CFD books. However, I had realized by teaching this course to various, not only IITs, I taught to various places also, I go for invited lectures in this subject. So what I had realized is that when I follow this approach, which is given in most of the CFD books, I had found difficult to connect to the audience, especially when you give CFD lectures to different colleges in our country, where the level of mathematics, especially for an undergraduate course, is little low, then there is a difficulty among the audience to get a feel and understanding of what is this Gauss divergence theorem. And another problem with this approach is that finally you get an algebraic equation. So when you are getting an algebraic equation, then you have coefficients. So the numerical procedure talks in terms of the coefficients. Then the connection of the fluid mechanics and heat transfer is broken to the numerics. So the approach, so this has motivated me to come up with an approach which is easy to feel and connect to. So this is an approach which I had been using since last maybe 3-4 years, where the idea is, let us start directly from a control volume, apply the conservation law, apply the approximations, which is in fact the approximations which are being used here are nothing different than what is given in most of the CFD books, or what is being mostly followed even if you start from a partial differential equation and do a volume integral. So the same approximations are used. So as we are here using same approximation, it is not surprising that we end up with same algebraic equations. So whether you start from a differential equation or whether you start directly from a control volume, as we are using same approximation, we end up with same algebraic equations. But it is just that in this approach, which I called as physics based approach, and the traditional method as mathematics based approach, I had found that students get a better feel. It is not only in the formulation, I try to make it physics based, even during the programming level or implementation details, I try that even when you are programming, I define terms like heat flux in the x direction, heat flux in the y direction. So rather than working coefficient based of an algebraic equations, it is more of a physics based. So programming also go hand in hand, and it is more of a physics based, because when you are programming, the different terms which you are having represents physical quantities. I hope you can understand and appreciate the objective. Okay, now in the previous lecture there is a second animation which I would like to show. This is the conservation law for momentum and energy equation. So the x momentum equation, the left hand side is the rate of change of term. Now, that rate of change, there are two terms, as we are following an Eulerian approach. Rate of change of x momentum inside the control volume plus across the control volume. And this rate of change, as you know from Newton's second law of motion, is equal to force. When you take a fluid control volume, most of the time, most commonly encountered forces are the viscous forces, pressure forces and the body forces. This is the x momentum. Similarly, we have a y momentum, which is also a transport equation, and energy equation, which is also a transport equation, and these are the different terms. Unsteady term, advection term, diffusion term, and whatever remaining is the source term. Okay, so this is, so in this topic of finite volume method, let us come back to the slide. So in this finite volume method, which is being discussed here, we are using finite volume method from the conservation law directly applied to the control volume. These are some of the things which I taught in the last lecture. I will not go into it. In the last lecture, before I finish the lecture, I had shown you the discretization of law of conservation of mass. This is different from diffusion, advection and convection. So this discretization is something new for as far as what has been discussed in the earlier topics. So anyway, I had shown you this discretization in the last lecture, and here again I had mentioned that this right now I am showing you the mass conservation law for incompressible flow, where the rate of change of mass, although it has two component, rate of change of mass inside the control volume plus across the control volume, what I am showing you here is rate of change of mass across the control volume, which is basically taking into consideration the mass fluxes, which is mass flow rate per unit area on the different surface of the control volume. And I had shown you that the two level of approximations are quite similar to what has been shown earlier, because mass flux is also a flux. So the approximation involved is similar to what we had done for conduction flux, enthalpy flux. So the first level approximation is as the flux varies on a surface area. So we are taking it by one point representation, which is a good approximation as the surface area goes on reducing. And anyway, in our CFD computations, we take the size of the control volume very small. But when we say very small, that small enough word depends upon what is the action of fluid flow and heat transfer in a particular problem. Each problem has its own story, each problem has its own action. So yesterday there were many questions that how do we decide the, to give you a simple example, let us suppose if you want to capture explosion, if you want to create, let us say, a movie of how explosion occurs, and if you want to capture each and every detail, you need a video camera which has very high temporal resolutions. Okay. And on the other hand, if there is some phenomena which is slow, you can have a camera which is a usual camera with a normal frame rate. So similarly, in fluid mechanics, just imagine that you have different, so that is the what I am calling as action. There are certain phenomena which are very changing rapidly in time. There are certain fluid flow phenomena which are not that rapid. So the grid, so the answer to the question, your question that what should be the grid size we should take, that depends upon our, that is guided by fluid mechanics and heat transfer. That is guided by how much action is occurring in a particular fluid flow problem or a heat transfer problem. Okay, so this is a philosophical understanding of how we decide the grid size. So in a particular problem, a priori many times you don't know how much action it is. So you take a grid size, you do a simulation, and then you do a second simulation with a larger number of grid points, and then when you compare the results between the two grid size, if there is more action, maybe probably you are, when you do on a larger grid point, the things have changed as compared to the first simulation. So this way you compare the result, and this is what is called as grid independent state. So the first level of approximation is surface averaging. And the second level approximation is what we had done earlier in conduction, and advection is basically the way we express the flux. Like heat flux, it is a function of gradient of temperature. The enthalpy flux is a function of value of temperature. Now these fluxes are at the phase center. So this value or gradient comes at the phase center, and the second level of approximation is basically the discrete representation of the value which we had done, what we called as advection scheme, and the gradient, the discrete representation of normal gradient of temperature in case of conduction. Now, here the flux is not conduction flux or enthalpy flux, the flux is mass flux. Now, the mass flux is expressed in terms of value of the velocity at the phase center. So, the second level of approximation is the discrete representation of the value of the normal velocity in terms of the neighboring cell center. Right now, I am showing you by using linear interpolation, assuming that the phase center is lying exactly in between the node capital P and capital E. But later on in the next lecture on staggered grid, I would show you that if you use this interpolation, it causes a wavy velocity field, which is obeying the continuity equation. So, people initially, if you look into the history of development of computational fluid dynamics, initially people were struggling in getting the solution from the Navier-Stokes equation, and there was alternative approach which was quite popular in the early days of CFD, which is called a stream function vorticity formulation, where you do not solve specifically mass conservation equation and you eliminate the pressure gradient term, because later on I will show you that this linear interpolation you not only do for velocities, but you need to also do for pressure, and this is what creates a lot of problem. And I will come back to more issues, more reasons why people were struggling in the next lecture. Now, so with this two approximation, we get a discrete or algebraic representation of the mass conservation law. Okay, this is where I had stopped in the last lecture, finite volume method for the so now we are moving on to, we started with the energy equation such as conduction and convection. Now, we are moving, increasing the scope. We started from energy, now we are including the momentum also along with energy, and what we are calling it as a transport equation. So, we are basically, now we will discuss momentum along with the energy equation, the discretization by physics based finite volume method. So, the way we handle the unsteady term is similar to what has been shown, but it is just that instead of temperature, I am showing you a general variable phi. So, earlier I had shown you that the first for unsteady term, the basic issue is that the in conduction I had told you that the rate of change of temperature in a volume, control volume varies point to point. So, we have, but in case of let us say x momentum, the u velocity temporal gradient, the rate of change of u velocity point to point varies. So, we need an average value in a volume. So, we do what we call as volume averaging. And the second level of discretization is discrete representation of that rate of change of temperature for energy, rate of change of u velocity for x momentum, rate of change of v velocity for y momentum equation. This is the final discrete or algebraic representation of the unsteady term. Now, from unsteady, let us go to the second term, which represents rate of change of momentum or enthalpy across the control volume. Note that unsteady term was representing inside the control volume, here now it is across the control. Now, in the advection term, the first level of approximation is again, I am showing you this first level is in fact the same. Basically, there are two situations which occur. If it is a flux term, then we have to do surface averaging, and earlier I had shown this for conduction flux, mass flux, and here I am showing you for x momentum flux also and y momentum flux. So, the first level of approximation is surface averaging of advection flux. And what is advection flux or what is advection is shown in this figure, calling it as a, in the earlier slide I had shown a more, in a more generic way, and in the coming next three slide I will be showing pictorially specifically corresponding to x momentum, y momentum and energy equation. So, if you take x momentum conservation, now the way we have put, actually the way we do in undergraduate courses is that we write this as at x, this as at x plus delta x, this at y and this at y plus delta y. And what is this? This is mass flow rate per unit area multiplied by u velocity. What is this? This is x momentum flux. So, this is just x momentum flux, which is expressed as small a here, called as advection flux. So, this advection flux here, which is x momentum flux multiplied by surface area, gives you the rate at which x momentum is entering into the control volume from this face, here from south face. Note that here in this case the mass flux which is a driver, the mass flux always consists of normal velocity. So, on this face the normal velocity is V. So, there is a u velocity and it is being carried away by the V velocity. So, that is why I had put the arrows like this. Okay, so, because many times you find it difficult to understand and appreciate that how this transport is occurring. So, what I am showing you here is that there is a u velocity as due to the flow and there is some mass flow on this phase, there is a v velocity and that v velocity carries this u velocity inside the control volume. And when it this v velocity carries this u velocity inside the control volume, there is a x momentum transport from the bottom phase, similarly from the top phase, and this is the x momentum which is leaving from the right phase. Note that the arrows which we use in derivation of partial differential equation, the same direction is used here. So, on the negative faces it is inflow, on the positive faces it is outflow. So, this when you do a balance, finally what you get is rate of change of x momentum of the fluid across the control volume. I would like to mention that why this is a first level of approximation, because this values mass flux velocities, this vary from point to point on the surface area. We are expressing by a one point value which is west. Note that in this control volume there is a small red line. That small red line here is representing the centroid of the surface area, denoted by small letters, small e, small w, small n and small s. Okay, so that way we are doing surface averaging, and that is what is first level of approximation for momentum flux here. Same thing we do for, maybe if I can show you through an animation, probably you get a better feel. I will show you the same thing in animation in this window. So, this is the x momentum transport in the x direction from the positive and negative faces. This is the y momentum transport in the vertical direction. This is the, sorry, everything here is the x momentum transport. Here this is an y momentum transport in the x direction. Now, here what I am showing you is that now on the vertical faces, now the v velocity, now v velocity is like a passenger, and what is the driver? The mass flow rate. Now, the mass flow rate consists of a normal velocity u. So, the v velocity is carried into the control volume by the driver, which is the u velocity, which is the normal velocity on the surface area. So, that is why the arrow here is shown like this. This is the way y momentum is transported from all the surfaces of the control volume. Fortunately, temperature does not have any direction. So, the direction of arrow is not here zigzag, it is straight arrows. However, there is a constant which is coming into this expressions, which is specific heat. So, this represents the first level approximation for advection term of energy equation, which finally represents rate of change of enthalpy of fluid across the control volume. Okay, so when you balance, I am showing here all the three slides as a single figure in a generic form. In all the three slides, earlier three slides, there was a mass flux. This constant was Cp in energy equation and one for momentum equation. So, I had given a general variable. What is this phi? This phi is a passenger or transported variable which is u velocity in x momentum, v velocity in y momentum and temperature in energy equation. So, this is a generic representation, because if there is certain commonality, generality, we develop program, test our program and then convert it into a module. So, we developed advection module and this is used three times. It is used in x momentum equation. So, we develop a subroutine for this advection, and in that subroutine when we want to calculate the total rate of change of x momentum across the control volume, we send to that subroutine that phi in that subroutine is u velocity, c is 1. Okay. Once you send this two information, this is a generalized subroutine. So, it follows a procedure and give us the total rate of change of x momentum across flowing across the control volume. For y momentum, phi is V, C is 1. For energy equation, phi is temperature, C is equals to Cp. Okay. So, this slide shows the generic representation, where phi is the advected variable and the product of the mass flux C and phi f is the advection flux. And this is the total balance we do. As this is an outflow minus inflow, if you take an energy equation, this is the total enthalpy which is leaving, this is the rate at which enthalpy is entering. So, that is outflux minus influx. So, this is total heat lost by advection in energy, total heat lost by total enthalpy or heat energy lost due to advection phenomenon. For x momentum, this is the total rate at which x momentum is lost when the fluid flow across the control volume. Similarly, for y momentum. And this is what I am showing separately. Many times you will see that I will show the same slide. But actually, these are the important concepts. Many times repetition, I know that when you write a research paper or when you teach, you want to avoid repetition. But these are concepts which take time for you to digest. So, that is why expecting that most of, as far as the CFD development is concerned, formulation is concerned, expecting that the most of the audience is looking at, had not gone through it in more detail. So, I show these things repeatedly, this is just to emphasize the concept. So, advection flux, as I said, is a generic form and these are the specific for x, y momentum and energy equation. Now, so that was the first level approximation. Now, the second level approximation is basically advection scheme, which we call as advection scheme. Earlier in my earlier lecture, I had shown you what is advection scheme. I had given you how we derive the expression for advection schemes. So, this is basically an extrapolation or interpolation procedure. I had discussed that this expressions which we derive is guided by the fluid mechanics and heat transfer principles. I had mentioned that in this mathematical procedure, we need to take into account the direction of mass flux, and based on the direction, we come to know which is the upstream neighbor, which is the downstream neighbor, which is the upstream of upstream neighbor, and based on that, the expressions are derived for advection scheme. So, note that everything we do in any mathematical procedure we adopt in CFD is guided by the fluid mechanics and heat transfer principle. This slide I had shown you earlier also. So, it is basically just to show what is the upstream neighbor and downstream neighbor, connecting to the example which I had discussed earlier, that ice and fire. So, if the flow is in this direction, flow is from the ice side, and if it is the first order of unit, then I had mentioned that the phase center value of the temperature. Now, here this is equally applicable for u velocity in x momentum equation, v velocity in the y momentum equation. And these are the different advection scheme which I had discussed earlier. Constant extrapolation first order operand scheme involving only one upstream neighbor. Linear interpolation, which is a central difference scheme involving one upstream and one downstream neighbor. Second order operand scheme, which is a linear extrapolation involving two upstream neighbors. Quick scheme, which involves one downstream and two upstream neighbors. In this figure, I am showing expressions for one case when the flow is in the positive x direction. There will be a similar equation for flow in the negative x direction. Moreover, I am showing you this on one of the phase center, east phase. But in a 2D control volume, there are four phase centers. So, this thing has to be applied on all the four phase centers, that is west phase center, north phase center and south phase center. However, a phase is common to two control volumes. So, because this east phase becomes west phase for this control volume. So, if you do a proper tagging and in your implementation, if you are good enough, you can avoid double computation and you compute only on the east phase and north phase for this control volume. When you go to this control volume, you calculate on the east phase and north phase, because this east is already being calculated from here. So, that way you can avoid. That is why I had shown you that those green squares and red inverted triangles, just to emphasize that how you can avoid double computations at the phase centers. And actually at the phase centers we have to do many things, mass fluxes, enthalpy fluxes, momentum fluxes, so conduction fluxes, viscous stresses. So if you do double computation and there are many fluxes, you unnecessarily waste time. And here I am showing you when you do a balance, here I am again showing you outflow minus inflow, you get total rate at which net momentum across the control volume for x direction and y direction. And this is the rate at which net and internal energy enthalpy across the control volume is lost due to advection heat transfer. So this is a total balance time. Okay, so we started with unsteady, moved on to advection, then we are going to diffusion. Now diffusion discretization we had already discussed for conduction heat transfer. The new thing here is that we will show you, I will show you that this is indeed applicable for the same approximations, the same procedure, the same finite volume method with a difference in the, instead of temperature, here you will have u velocity for x momentum, v velocity for y momentum. But the expressions are quite similar, instead of conductivity here you will have a dynamic viscosity. So first level approximation is same what I discussed for conduction fluxes, that we do surface averaging. This is there for any flux. So the first level approximation is surface averaging of diffusion flux to calculate the total diffusion. And the second level, so I am here showing you what is diffusion flux for x momentum equation. The diffusion flux for x momentum equation is the viscous forces in the x direction. Note that pressure I will take separately, here I am showing you only viscous forces. And I had shown you in my first lecture that for an incompressible flow, although the generic expression for sigma xx is 2 mu del u by del x, the general expression for sigma yx is mu del u by del y plus del v by del x. But for incompressible flow, I had shown you in my previous lecture, topic number 1, you can refer to the slides, that we can simplify and instead of 2 mu del u by del x, if we take 1 mu del u by del x, and instead of 1 mu del u by del x, if you take from here and you take mu del v by del x, then by applying continuity equation, it can be shown that it becomes 0. So that way we simplify the expression of viscous stress in the x direction as a function of velocity gradient. And the purpose of this simplification is to demonstrate that the diffusion flux is expressed in terms of normal gradient of a diffused variable. Now that diffused variable is u velocity for x momentum, v velocity for y momentum and temperature for energy equation. Now the diffusion coefficient, because this viscous term, viscous stresses or conduction heat fluxes are directly proportional to the gradient, but there is a constant of proportionality, and that constant of proportionality varies from fluid to fluid, material to material. And what is that constant of proportionality? Dynamic viscosity for fluid flow and kinematic viscosity for conduction heat transfer. So if you take copper versus let us say iron, or if you take two fluid, let us say water versus air or oil, you can see that the diffusion phenomena will be different. So with this I am showing you that this diffusion fluxes, which is a viscous stress in the x direction, are expressed at the centroid of the surface area. So that is what is first level of approximation. This is same thing is shown for viscous stresses in the y direction. Note that in the previous slide, this wherever now there is a u, in the previous slide it was, sorry, in the previous slide this was u, now here is v. And you can see that where this sigma xy is acting, this sigma xy is acting on the vertical surfaces. What is the normal to this vertical surface? X, and that we are taking the gradient in the x direction. So this is in general a viscous stress is directly proportional to normal gradient, and that is what happened in conduction heat fluxes also. Note that the arrows, direction of arrows are different, like in x momentum all arrows are horizontal. All arrows in case of viscous stress acting in the y direction, they are vertical, but in conduction it's in the in our in the viscous forces, force is a vector there, that way you show it as an arrow, but here the way we are showing actually this is a total rate of heat transfer, here we are showing it as an inflow and outflow. So from the negative surface we take inflow and from the positive surface we take as an outflow. So this is the total diffusion where this eta represents the surface normal direction, the coordinate corresponding to the surface normal, and this gamma phi is dynamic viscosity for fluid flow and conductivity for heat transfer. Now this is the diffusion flux shown for fluid flow, it is a viscous stress, for momentum transport and for heat transfer it is a conduction heat flux. And the discretization is what I had been discussing earlier. For conduction the same thing is shown here, the second level of discretization is piecewise linear approximation, this I had shown earlier for heat conduction, the same thing is shown here in a generic way. And this is that when you balance the total diffusion outflow minus inflow, this represents net viscous forces acting in the x direction. I would like to mention actually there is, I am showing you here as outflow minus inflow, but in the previous slide I would like you to note that this diffusion coefficient I am not showing it as minus k, I am showing it as a plus k intentionally to have a generic expression, because what happens is that for forces I have to take forces acting on the positive faces minus forces acting on the negative faces, but when I go to the heat transfer, if I take positive faces minus negative faces it becomes conduction outflux minus conduction influx. And you remember that in my conduction topic I had talked about influx minus outflux, and I always used to say heat gain, conduction heat gain, rate of change of internal energy equals to total heat gained by conduction. So to have a same physical interpretation, here gamma I am taking as plus k, but when you take here positive faces minus negative faces and when it is a minus k, now this that minus k finally when you talk of heat in terms of heat transfer, although it seems to be outflux minus influx, but as I instead of minus k I had taken plus k, this finally gives us total heat gained by conduction heat transfer. This is just for a generic representation, because in a program this is the way we calculate the total viscous force in the x direction, viscous force in the y direction, but when we are calculating the conduction fluxes we want to have a physical interpretation, not as conduction heat lost by the control volume, but to have a physical interpretation that it is heat gained by the conduction heat transfer, I had used that. Okay, so this completes the unsteady term, advection term, diffusion term, all this I had already discussed in case of heat transfer in separate topics, computational heat conduction for diffusion, computational heat advection for advection phenomena, and the combination I had discussed in convection. And here just I had demonstrated that for fluid flow also there is an advection phenomena, there is an advection term, there is an advection flux, there is a diffusion flux. So it is just a repetition with a certain generality. And note that the level of discretizations which was used earlier in heat transfer, the same discretizations, the same approximations are being used here to get an algebraic equation. Now we are left with the source term. Now the source term is the pressure force and the volumetric heat transfer, pressure force for momentum transport. So how do we represent pressure force? Pressure force is always acting normal to the surface area. Now pressure is also per unit area term, it's a pressure is a force per unit area, it's just a different types of force different from the viscous force. Now pressure is also a flux because it's a per unit area term. So the first level approximation is same as that what we use for all the fluxes, surface averaging to represent phase on a surface, on the surface of a control volume, that is surface averaging which is shown here. And the second level of approximation is expression to calculate pressure at the face center in terms of neighboring cell center. This we had done for mass flux also for the normal velocity. Note that if you look into the discretization, unsteady adduction diffusion I had shown you earlier. There are two discretization which I am showing you new in this topic. One is that mass flux and second is this pressure force, because in our heat transfer we do not have an analogous term. And second level of approximation, so this is the first level of approximation, this is second level of approximation. Now in this slide I am showing you the first level of approximation to calculate the pressure force in the x direction. Okay, note that although pressure is acting on all the four surfaces, but just to demonstrate the pressure force acting in the x direction, I am just showing you this pressure force and this pressure force. This I will be showing you for pressure force in the y direction. Okay, in a discrete form, how you do this is that you, this is the pressure force in the positive x direction, this is the pressure force in the negative x direction. So you take the difference of positive force and the negative force and divide by the volume. Surface area divided by volume gives you delta y in the denominator, and you get px plus delta x, sorry, px minus px plus delta x. So this will become your px, this will become your px plus delta x. So px minus px plus delta x, area is delta y here. When you divide by volume, you get delta x delta y. Delta y cancels down, and when you apply the limit, you get minus del p by del x. Here in this case, by first level approximation, you have expressed the pressure at the centroid of the control volume, and by second level approximation, you can write p small e is equals to p capital P plus p capital E divided by 2, p small w is equals to p capital P plus p capital W divided by 2, and then you can obtain algebraic representation of this pressure force for this control volume. Similarly, you can calculate the pressure force in the y direction. This slide shows you the total heat gained by volumetric heat generation. In most of the heat transfer problem, volumetric heat generation is expressed as Q bar, expressed here as Q bar is known to us. And in case this volumetric heat generation is varying point to point, then here the approximation, the first level approximation is that we are representing the point by point variation of volumetric heat flux, volumetric heat generation as a value at the centroid of the control volume. However, in most of the cases, this volumetric heat generation does not vary point to point. So, we can take it as a constant, and here it is taken at the centroid. Okay, so with this, I had come towards the end of this topic, but before that, I will show you the slides showing the all the discretization. So let me show through an animation. So this is the term representing rate of change of x momentum of the fluid inside the control volume. Note the word inside here. This is rate of change of x momentum of the fluid flowing across the control volume. Note the word across. This is equals to viscous force acting in the x direction, which represents diffusion phenomenon. This is the source term, pressure force acting in the x direction. Similarly, when you go to the y momentum, this is the rate of change of y momentum of the fluid inside the control volume. This is an adduction term, this represents rate of change of y momentum across the control volume. This is the viscous forces acting in the y direction. This is the pressure force acting in the y direction. For energy equation, this is the rate of change of internal energy or enthalpy of the fluid or solid inside the control volume. This is the rate of change of enthalpy or heat energy of the fluid across the control volume. This is the total heat gained by conduction, and this is the total heat gained by volumetric heat generation. So with this, I had completed the topic on finite volume method. Thank you for your attention. What I will do is that I will take one or two questions before moving on to the next topic. JNTU Hyderabad.
In the topic 6, slide number 35, while explaining the net conduction heat transfer for energy conservation, it is explained that the rate of change of internal energy represents the total heat gained by conduction. Is it rate of change of internal energy or enthalpy?
So the question is, in the left hand side of law of conservation of energy, let me just see if I can open that. I use this word internal energy enthalpy quite alternatively, or what I actually mean is that here we are talking of incompressible fluids, where both the term can be interchangeably used. So that is why I had used this word, but if you go for compressible flows, then this definition will not be correct. So for an incompressible fluid, this I can either use an enthalpy or a internal energy. So that is what I had restricted to. So whatever I am teaching here is related with an incompressible fluid, where this definition is okay. Thank you.
Sir, another question is, while explaining these animations of the x momentum equation, you have used the diffusion term. Can you show the corresponding governing equation or the momentum equation?
So the question is, while showing the control volumes for the diffusion term, in the x momentum I had shown you the, actually what happens is, so the question is, can I show the differential form? Let me do one thing, let me show in the whiteboard how from the, let me go to the control volume and then I can probably do in a better way. So the question is basically to show the viscous forces which I had shown at the faces of the control volume in terms of a differential form. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so let me go to the slide where I had shown that control volume. Okay, let us take this, and what I will do is that on the whiteboard I will show you that how we get a differential form of it. That is what the question is. So the control volume is this control volume. Now when you, right now I had shown you as sigma, in the surface, if I want to draw the viscous force in the x direction, this is a normal stress, so this will be sigma xx. On this surface, again it will be sigma xx. On this surface, note that now the plane is y, so the first subscript will be y, and the direction, sorry. The direction which we are taking is x, so the second subscript will be x. On the bottom surface, here again it will be sigma yx. Now in a finite volume, I had expressed this as at the east face, this I had expressed at west face, this at north face center, this at south face center, where these are the centroids of the control volume, sorry, centroid of not the control volume, but the surface areas. However, when you want to do differential representation, we do not use this approximation. So instead of the small e, this will be at x plus dx, this small w will be at x, this small n will be y plus dy, this small s will be y, and then when you do a balance, let us say we do a balance for the faces in the vertical, forces in the vertical direction, it will become sigma xx x plus dx, this is in the positive x direction, this is in the negative x direction. So it will become minus of sigma xx at x, we are talking of force, so this has to be multiplied by surface area, and what is the surface area? Delta y. And then this is, when we take the horizontal surface, this will become sigma yx at x plus, sorry, y plus dy. Now, here the surface area is delta x. Then we apply, what we do, we want a differential term. So, right now this is the total force acting in the x direction. To convert into a differential term, we have to obtain force per unit volume. So, when you divide by the volume, which is delta x, delta y, here delta y cancels down. In this case, delta x cancels down, and then you use limit. Here you use limit delta x tends to 0, here you use limit delta y tends to 0, and you obtain del by del x of sigma xx plus del by del y of sigma yx, which is del dot sigma second order tensor. We will stop the interaction.